some of those great crab legs and crab fries that made Chickies and Pete so famous.
It's the Sports Best, this and every Thursday from 2 to 6, live at Chickies and Pete's in the Tropicana in Atlantic City.
All right, 1:22 on a Thursday. We'll take up to 2 o'clock. Keep it locked in. Rich Quiñones here. We'll get to your calls on the other side, as well as the text messages. So just have a couple moments of patience. Lake Lewis does a great job covering the NFL, watching the Redskins Insider. Does TV work as well. USA Today, kind enough to join me for a couple moments on a Thursday as the Washington Redskins get set to take on the Dallas Cowboys tonight. A very, really a must-win game for both these squads. How you been, pal?
I'm good, man. How you been? Happy Thanksgiving, by the way.
You too. Best to your family, as always. All right, what's the sentiment tonight in this game? When you look at the Washington Redskins, who have really been dealt some major blows with some of these injuries over the last several weeks, and I think the Chris Thompson loss was absolutely huge, but what's your feeling down there with the Skins right now?
This is a game that they have to win. Obviously, both teams do if they have any, inkling of hope, as far as making the playoffs as a wild card team. But I think the Redskins are in better shape than Dallas right now. Believe it or not, with some of the injuries that they've had, they're getting some guys back. They're never going to be 100%, at least, not the remainder of this year. But this might be the first time in weeks where, they've had some participation in practice from guys. I mean, it's been bad where they haven't even really been able to field a lot of practices with some of their frontline guys. So I think they're in good shape. I think this is a winnable game. I think, if they can control the football, run the ball a little bit more, I think they can come out of Dallas with the victory.
When you look at Kirk Cousins this year, it seems as though it's like a game-by-game audition for him. And I'm just wondering, at the end of the day, do they need to have a strong start in order for this franchise to really believe he's the quarterback going forward? Or does he just statistically have to put up numbers, or they have to get a wild card? How do you think it's going to play out?
I think a lot of that stuff is hyperbole that's coming from outside, media. I know, with us, we're there every day. We cover this team, travel with the team, and I think most people in the organization, I don't think I know. They know what this guy's capable of, and I don't think he has to convince anybody going forward. It's just a matter of numbers. That's all this boils down to. Is this guy, a guy that we've seen be productive, but do you really want to pay him record-breaking quarterback numbers? That's what this boils down to. And the Redskins are going to have a hard decision to make there. It's not a hard decision as far as Kirk Cousins, the quarterback. He's proven that, he's Pro Bowl caliber guy. He'll throw another 4,000 yards this season, which will make it 3 years in a row. But again, do you want to pay a guy that's really not talent-wise a top-five quarterback the number one quarterback contract? And I think you may have to just the way the game goes. It's the NFLQ is kind of like the NBA, where on a given year, a team may have to, give max money to a player that's really not the best player on that team, but it's just the going rate. We saw that in Washington with Bradley Beal, and everyone knows that's John Wall's team.
Right.
But until John Wall came back the year later and signed the max contract, it was Bradley Beal as far as contract-wise. And that's where the Redskins are with Kirk Cousins.
It's typically what the market bears. When you look at this game tonight and on the other side of the ball, another young quarterback in Dak Prescott, and having Carson Wentz in our backyard with the Eagles and looking at the quarterback play in the NFC East, the one thing about Prescott is I still think he's a good quarterback. He's a young quarterback. He's having that sophomore slump. You take away a couple of the things, the line, the ground game. I get it. But I'm also seeing a trend here with some of these warts and how they rear their ugly head, not being able to, his progressions, his reads, the fact that he's not as accurate as you probably like him to be in the pocket, outside the pocket. It's incredible some of the throws he makes. But again, there's got to be consistency there. With that being said, there's going to be really no threat of Dallas running the football. With Elliott, they're able to do it in the second half to wear you down. So Washington defensively, you think they're just going to say, okay, we don't even need to stack the box. Go and beat me with your arm.
Yeah, but I do think the Redskins know that they're going to have to take Dallas's running game away. I mean, just to be effective, Alfred Morris, former Redskin, I think the kid, Rod Smith, who reminds me size-wise of like a Michael Pittman-type player. You know, he's a strong back. So the Redskins still are going to have to take Dallas's running game away from them. And yeah, they're going to, you know, dare Dak Prescott to beat them, not with his legs, but with his arm. A couple weeks ago, week eight, when Dallas came to town and beat the Redskins, it was, you know, raining, it was wet. And Prescott, you know, basically gassed him, and so did, you know, Zeke Elliott. The running game was there. No Zeke Elliott for Dallas. It's amazing how one guy can really make that much of a difference in an offense. But they haven't been the same team without him, and I understand their offensive line's been beat up too. But I tell you what, no one in Washington is going to, you know, no one back in D.C. is going to cry a river for the Cowboys.
No.
As far as injuries.
No, they're not.
So, yeah. I did want to say this though, Q. I think what you're seeing sometimes too in these young quarterbacks, when everything's set up to be successful around them, they're successful.
No doubt.
But as far as the days of quarterbacks coming in and just willing teams to victories,
no more.
You're probably going to only have one or two of those special type players every 5-6 years. Everyone else is going to be a game manager that's asked on occasion to beat you, and that's kind of what Kirk Cousins has been over the years. And now they're asking him to win games with, you know, not the same two guys he's had on the outside over the years, and he's actually starting to do that. And I think that just comes with maturity and time under center.
Yeah, well, look what's going on in New York right now with Manning. You lose all these players on the you lose all these players on the offensive defensive side of the ball. The defense is not nearly as where it should be. They're ranked dead last. You got players. You got the dissension. You know, I go back and it still goes back to the way he's handled. And this is not an Odell Beckham problem or issue. It's how he you can't be this hardliner in the beginning and then soft. And you can't be soft and then you can't be a hardliner. You know, fix your personality a little bit and bend, but don't break. And the problem is, this head coach from the get-go has never saw eye to eye, has never seen eye to eye with the quarterback, the franchise quarterback, by the way. And he's just never he's had no problem firing darts at him, but he's never called anyone else out. But he'll do it to the quarterback, and that's what I have a problem with.
Well, you guys are a lot closer to that than I am, but I can just tell you from afar what I've always said I didn't like with the Giants and this whole situation. It supersedes Eli. It goes back to Tom Coughlin.
I agree.
You get rid of the coach and keep everything else in place, and there's no mystery now that the issue wasn't Tom Coughlin.
No.
It was the guy upstairs that's bringing in the talent.
Yep.
They haven't addressed that offensive line since we've been little kids.
By the way, he inherited that quarterback, by the way. He inherited those Super Bowls and that quarterback. So
Yeah, he did. He did. But they've never addressed the offensive line, and I don't care who you're drafting and who, I mean, you could draft another young quarterback in this year's draft, or you can draft Barkley or someone from Penn State. You still don't have an offensive line. And until that's addressed, the Giants are gonna have these kind of results. The sad part about it is they've probably wasted, you know, people talk about Eli being on a downslide over the last 2 years. Yeah, he has been. He's getting older. That happens naturally. But when you don't have an offensive line or a running game,
they did him a disservice from a
37-year-old quarterback.
They wasted the last several years of his career. They really did him a disservice. And, you know, it's funny, too, because when you start to bring up the conversation of where certain quarterbacks might land, like, you play the game all the time, right? Same thing with Cousins. Even though Garoppolo's in San Francisco, nobody knows. A lot of times, I believe, either if a reporter or someone in the media hears about a team where you want to link a player, it's because that team decided to leak it or the player's agent decided to.
No, right.
Yeah, listen, I don't.
I get called to do it all the time.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So my point is, no, there's no clear cut Eli's not coming back or he's going to Jacksonville or Denver. Nobody. I still think this is a fluid motion, just like in D.C. with Cousins. Nobody knows. If Cousins decides to walk and San Francisco pays him a ton of money, they can do that even though they have Garoppolo. Nobody knows. I think there's 10 teams out there right now that would love a Kirk Cousins. I mean,
that's just me. But I do too, but I tell you what, and you heard it here first, and both those gentlemen will be under center next year for their current teams. And You heard it from me, and I'm pretty.
You think Cousins will be in Washington? You'll still think Eli's going to take snaps for the Giants?
Absolutely.
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. How do you sit there and turn around the way the organization comes out and they knew they made a mistake, and then hey, Lake, go out and play a half, and then you're coming out the second half. I mean, this isn't Pop Warner.
Well, but you've heard Mara come out and say that he wished that was handled differently. He wasn't in the building. I'm sure they probably brought to his attention and. You know, again, it backfired. But I can tell you what, the quick way to fix something like that is you get rid of the GM, you get rid of the coach, and you have your quarterback who, and you still can, you know, maybe go out and draft a Rosen or a Darnold if they're available, and then you just have them wait for 1 year. It's not like Eli's going to be playing for 3-4 years.
No.
I mean, you could have him under center for 1 year, maybe even give way to them at some point next year if he's struggling. You'll have Beckham back. You may have, you know, another free agent come in, wide receiver. So the point is, you know, everything will be set up for you to do what was expected for the Giants this past year. And I just think that this guy, you know, the coach lost this team a long time ago.
Yeah, I do.
A long time ago.
And listen, you know this because you go back when I remember the cup of coffee that Zorn had with the Washington Redskins. That was a debacle.
Yeah.
You know, Shanahan as well. Shanahan with the issue with RG3. That was a debacle. And you're talking about an 11-5 team. 11-5 team last year that made the playoffs. And now they're staring down the barrel of 2-14, 3-13.
Yeah, I'm still dealing with some fans here saying that Jay Gruden needs to be fired, you know, and I'm like, are you kidding me? This guy has – it's one thing to lose games. It's another thing to be competitive. They had the Saints on the ropes. They had the Chiefs on the ropes. This is in two of the most hostile environments. They probably should have won those games.
Should have beat them. Yeah, should have beat the Saints.
Yeah. Absolutely. The only game that I really think that the Redskins just got ran over was in Philadelphia.
Yep.
And – but you could see in that game, you know, they still had some things that worked for them. But you know, for me, this might be Jay Gruden's best coaching job, to say the least.
And when you had those injuries, same thing could be said with Zimmer in Minnesota. Look at the job he's doing. 2 years in a row, you lose your quarterback and you lose your running back.
Yeah, I mean, what more can you expect from someone at that point? The Redskins were never a Super Bowl contender in the first place. They were a team that always, you know, sniffed around a wild card spot, you know, and that's exactly where they are right now. I mean, if they go on a little run here, maybe 4 out of 5, they'd be a team that missed the playoffs, you know, by a game or two, you know. So they are where they're supposed to be, you know, at this point, and that's fighting for a playoff berth, a wild card berth. Maybe the record hadn't had the injuries. Maybe they could have had 2-3 more wins, maybe 2 more. But that still is not guaranteeing you a spot in the playoffs. You're still going to have to fight for it, and that's where they are right now.
Yeah,
so I think Jay Gruden should be safe, if anything.
You might get 3 coming out of the South. Listen, before I let you get out of here, AFC side of the football, you know, the Patriots are the Patriots, and they've had Pittsburgh's number over the last several years. Give me a team, a dark horse team, that you think if they get in, they can, I don't want to say make a run, but at least compete with the Patriots.
I've had it, and I've had this team before they turn the corner.
Can I guess before you say it?
Go ahead.
You're going to say the Chargers.
I absolutely am.
Yeah, I said that yesterday.
I absolutely am. I mean, people keep saying, oh, come on, you're jumping on the bandwagon. Do you see how they lost those first 4 or 5 games of the season? I mean, those were missed field goals.
Yep.
Just bad. Something horrific happened.
Yep.
They easily win 2 or 3 2 or 3 of those first 5 games. I mean, you're talking about a true contender, and we're just talking about a team that can get in and cause some problems. I actually think they're winning their division. I really do. And I think that they're going to get in there. And let's face it, there's only 2 teams, and you just mentioned them, New England and Pittsburgh, that are really worth talking about. you know, so now if you have to throw a dark horse in there, that's going to be my dark horse, because Kansas City looks like chopped meat right now. They're done.
Let me ask you that real quick before we wrap it up. So Kansas City, we know about the issues. You know, they were the darlings to the beginning of the season. This is why you can never win the division in September, October. You can lose it, though. But now you're seeing the struggles of Smith and then Andy Reid. Do you think if they collapse, Andy Reid, you know, there's murmurs that you got to get rid of the head coach and you also got to get rid of the quarterback?
No, not at all, because Kansas City, and I'm sorry to say this because I know they have a steep history and things like that, but, you know, they're a team that is you know, they're going to be competitive. They're going to be good on occasion. But let's face it, you know, they haven't won a Super Bowl in 40 years. I mean, you know, or they didn't win it when they got there. So my point is there are teams that are around the league that you see have something going on. And then there's teams that are just, they're good, but they're not championship caliber. The team right there in your market, you know, the Eagles, they've got something going on right now. And I'm more scared about them next year and the year after, not this year. If they get in the playoffs this year and lose, I wouldn't look at that as a I wouldn't look at it as a waste of a season. I'm almost setting myself up to believe that that's probably what's going to happen. Everything's gone so well for them. They're a great young football team, and that's the key word, young. But you know, and I know, you know, not taking it from the Kansas City conversation, but with Philadelphia, a Minnesota that is a team that's primed to give them trouble in a playoff situation.
I think so,
even
too.
Even with Case Keenum, just because of the way their defense plays. Who's to say a Seattle has to come east? You know, they don't have any offense, but they still have, you know, a pedigree about them. They've been there. That's when things starting to tighten up a little bit. I just think going back to now to Kansas City, they don't have that. I mean, they just, Andy Reid has come in and changed the Kansas City Chiefs. He's made them relevant, but we all know what Andy Reid's history is come crunch time and playoff time.
Sure. Clock
so,
management. Yep, tightens up.
Yeah. A little bit.
Yeah, a little bit. That's an understatement. All right, my friend, enjoy the game tonight. We will talk next week. Always appreciate the perspective and the analysts and the dialogue. Have a good weekend. Enjoy the games. We'll talk next week.
All right, take care, my friend. I appreciate it.
You got it. Anytime. Lake Lewis, great stuff, as always. He brought up an